and we're so glad you've joined us today. If you're new to Warm Beach Church, welcome. We would love for you to stop by Warm Beach Cafe for a free drink.
Our Warm Beach Cafe is open before both services. This is a great opportunity to grab a latte, espresso, or hot chocolate while supporting our students and youth ministry.
We hope you grabbed a copy of the sermon notes on your way in. This is a great way to follow along with the sermon and write down what God is speaking to you. You will also find a Connect card in the seat back in front of you. The Connect card is a great way to share prayer requests, ask questions, or connect with the pastor. You can fill it out and drop it in the offering box on your way out.
If you came prepared with a tithe or offering, we have a few different options for you. You can visit our website at wbfmc.org and click the Give button on the homepage, or you can give through our church app.
And if you brought your gift with you this morning, you can place it in the offering box at any time.
Let's worship Jesus together.
Well, good morning, church. It's good to be here with you this morning. I'm Pastor Morgan, and this is...
I'm Jake.
He's Jake. There you go. You know Jake. I want to welcome you here to church. Want to also let you know that this next Saturday is another one of our men's breakfast. And, you know, the women tried to outdo us at their women's brunch the last time they had that. I actually snuck in and ate more food than I should have. But, men, we've got to outdo that. So this coming Saturday... at 8 a.m., we'll be in here, we'll cook a lot of meats, and we'll have pancakes, and of course, there will be real maple syrup, not any of that fake stuff that they make. But I want to invite you to come, bring your sons, bring your neighbors, it doesn't matter what age you are, but come and be a part of that. And that's next Saturday, here in this space at 8 a.m., and so we're just going to look forward to a good time together. We want to take a moment in the service. I think many of you probably received an email from us on Thursday sharing some news with you about the Knight family. And we just wanted to take a moment, you know, at the beginning of the service just to acknowledge that and also to honor Pastor Jake and his family. And they've been here for a while. They've been here for over 6 years. And it's just been incredible to see their family grow. Their ministry grow and to get to do ministry together with them. And so I asked Pastor Jake if he would just take a moment and just share his thoughts and his heart with you this morning at the beginning of the service.
Yeah, my first thought is we still got some time. We don't plan on going anywhere for the rest of the school year. And so we're excited for what is in store for this school year. We're excited for, first of all, our fall retreat. That's coming up. I don't know if you saw the slide beforehand, but that's coming up, and we're looking forward to what God has in store for us over these next few months. We really have zero idea or even inkling of what's next, and so there's a bit of a, oh wow, all right, it's out there. We said it. It's time, but you know, God's good, and we're trusting Him through this whole process, and looking forward to what He's got in store for us, but also excited about what we get to be a part of while we're still here. And so those are my thoughts.
Yeah, and I think I think it would be appropriate for us to say thank you to Pastor Jake, and he's not going anywhere yet, right? So, and he's not dying, that's not, you know, right? So you're not dead yet. So yeah, no, lots of ministry happening. And when we get towards the end, we'll have a time of celebration that, but more so, I just want to say how proud I am of Jake and Melissa. It's hard to step out in faith like this. You know, they have a sense that the transition is coming, but they don't know where yet. And that's where we get to be a part of what God is doing in their lives. So we get to pray for them, that God would just show them and walk them out in this step of faith. And so we're going to actually take a moment right now, and I invite you to just join me as I pray over Pastor Jake and Melissa and the boys, that God would reveal His plans for them, and that He would not only provide for them, but also provide for our church too. And so would you join me as we pray this morning? Father, I thank you so much for the ministry of Pastor Jake. I thank you for bringing he and Melissa here years ago. I thank you for just all the ways that you have used them to further your kingdom here in our church and in our community. I thank you for how you've expanded their family and allowing them to have two more boys since they've been here. I thank you for the ways that they use their gifts and abilities in worship and in the cafe and our youth ministry and really just in so many different places. And I thank you that you lead in such a way that you don't give us all the information, but you call us out into these places of developing and growing our faith in you. And I pray that during this next season that you would continue to richly bless Pastor Jake's ministry here at our church. And as he and Melissa look forward to what you have next for them, I pray that you would lead them with courage into that. And I pray that you would remind us that we get to be a part of that faith-building process as well. And I look forward to the day, God, when we get to look back on how you moved and how you worked and how you provided, and we get to worship you and praise you for the God that you are. And so I pray that you would do all of these things in and through Pastor Jake and Melissa and their family, and in and through our church. I ask that you would just continue to bless. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, I want to invite, let's stand, and I want to read some scripture for us as we enter into this time of worship. I often find myself going back to Paul's words most of the time because Paul's awesome, and he's great, and he writes really good. But I want to read for us from his letter to the Ephesian church as we just to help center and focus our hearts and our minds back on Christ and get us in, lead us into it this time of worship. But let me read for us Ephesians 2, starting in verse 11. Paul writes, "So then, remember that at one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcised by those called the circumcised, which is done in the flesh by human hands. At that time you were without Christ, excluded from the citizenship of Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who made both groups one and tore down the dividing wall of hostility. In his flesh, he made of no effect the law consisting of commands and expressed in regulations, so that he might create in himself one new man from the two, resulting in peace. He did this so that he might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross, by which he put the hostility to death. He came and proclaimed the good news of peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole building being put together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you are also being built together for God's dwelling in the Spirit." And these are some of my absolute favorite words found in Scripture. But jumping ahead to the end of chapter 3, Paul tells us, "Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen." We worship the living God who is over everything. And so let's worship him together.
Come to the well that never commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else could make every king bow down? Who else could whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises?
Good morning, everyone. You may be seated. 1 John 4:19 says, "We love because he first loved us." And so this morning, I want to walk us through, or expose us rather, to some scripture this morning. Has anybody ever asked themselves this question, what is God's will for my life? Yes, that should be everybody, hopefully. Well, the cool thing is that we can know what that is. And has everybody asked themselves the question, I want to hear God speak to me? Yeah, you don't have to raise your hand, sorry. I'm just like to high five you, air five. Okay, but I would assume that the answer is yes. And so when we read God's word and he exposes and reveals himself to us, that is him speaking to us. And so this morning I want to walk us through the Shema. And does anyone know what the Shema is? Yeah, several, okay. Yeah, so I'm going to walk us through the Shema, and we're going to read it together. I'm going to invite you to do that in just a moment. And the reason why I'm going to do that is we're going to read that as God's will for our life. And so in that, there's a natural exposing or understanding that the writer of Deuteronomy, Moses, points out. And we're going to, it's pretty self-explanatory, so I don't have to explain that. In Matthew 22, when the Pharisees asked Jesus to try to trap him, they said, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And he starts with the Shema. And then he moves on to the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. And I think there's a reason, there's an order to that. And that's, and this is from a devotion I was doing earlier this week. When our hearts belong to the Master, Jesus, and are pointed to the Master, from that flows our love for other people. And so I'm going to invite you to stand. It's unusual if you can or if you want to. I would invite you to stand as we read the Shema this morning. So if you would stand, please. And we're going to read that together. It'll be on the screen, unless you would like to hold your Bible there. There it is. Okay. But I'm going to pray first, and then we'll read the Shema together as God's will for our life. Father God, I ask that you would help us understand this passage, that you would give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, and that in that you wouldn't use that knowledge to puff us up, but that you'd help us to love you and others more and to correct any understanding or misunderstanding, rather, that we have about you in doing so. And I ask, Lord, that you would establish in us, in our minds, in our hearts, a knowledge and a desire to love you because you loved us first. And that in that, God, we see and we know that you love us so much because of all the laws that you give the Israelites. It's all about our hearts that you want. So help us to be reminded of that this morning. Amen. If you'd read with me, please. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Amen? Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Matt, for walking us through that. I have asked Pastor Matt to once a quarter start leading us through some liturgy. Liturgy is a very important act. What it does is it teaches us things that Scripture wants us to know that we can live and breathe and act in. And so I appreciate his leadership and his teaching us and walking us through that. And thank you for your participation in that. Before we get into this morning's message, I just want to take a moment and say that was a little bit of a different Sunday last week, wasn't it? To be very honest with you, where I would rather be right now is just down in my office. This morning brought with it a lot of just how do I walk after last Sunday? Monday was really interesting to me. I came into the office after being very transparent and vulnerable last Sunday, and I thought to myself, what do I do? Do I just go back to being the way I was? Do I pretend nothing happened yesterday? Do do I walk through that? And so I thought that I needed to just take a moment before I brought the message this morning just to acknowledge something. And here's what I'd like to acknowledge this morning. It's okay to not be okay. Let me just say that again. It's okay to not be okay. I think many of us, we live our lives believing that we just have to pretend to be okay even when we're not okay. And God doesn't ask us of that. He doesn't expect that of us. In fact, He would rather us get to the place of just simply acknowledging that we're not okay so that He can help us. It's okay to not be okay. Here's a second fundamental truth, though, that we need to hear this morning. God doesn't want to leave us in that place of not being okay. It's okay to not be okay, but God's plan isn't for us to stay stuck in that not being okay. He actually wants to bring healing. He wants to bring life. He wants to bring transformation. He wants to do a work in us that goes beyond anything that we're capable of ourselves. And He does this in several different ways, one of which is He places us in community. I mentioned just a few moments ago that I'd love to just run and hide right now. But that's not how God designed us to be. God has actually designed us to be in community. And the way that I move out of not being okay is to surround myself with people who can listen and encourage and pray and say, you're not alone in all this. And so the way that I'm moving out of my space of not being okay is I'm surrounding myself with people who love me, who encourage me, who challenge me, who pray for me, who spend time with me. The other way that God moves us out of not being okay is He brings the presence of His Holy Spirit into our lives. He brings healing. He brings Himself, and He reminds us of who we are in Him. And so one of the ways that we move out of not being okay is we spend time with Him. And we need to be in His Word. We need to be praying. We need to be listening and worshiping Him. And we need to be spending time with Him so that He can do the work in us to move us out of that space. And so I want to share that with you this morning, that before we even get into this morning's message, that while I would love to say to you, I'm okay, I'm not, I'm getting there, but I'm not there yet. What I'm doing in the process is I'm spending time in community with people who I trust and who I know care for me and care about me, but I'm also spending time with God as well. I'm making sure that I don't neglect the time that I get to spend with Him so that He can do the work in me that I cannot do on my own. And if you're like me, if you're saying this morning, just sitting there, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand like Pastor Matt did, but if you're sitting there and you're thinking to yourself, I'm not okay, I want you to hear this morning, it's okay to not be okay. But God's desire for you is not for you to stay there. He wants to bring you towards healing. And so I would invite you to get into some community. Surround yourself with people who can speak life into you, who can pray for you, who can encourage you. Spend time with people who will listen to you. And most importantly, spend time with God, because God knows exactly what you need, and He knows exactly how to bring the healing that you need in your life. And so I wanted to share that with you this morning. And I also wanted to say thank you to all of you who have reached out to me, those of you who have sent me text or emails, those of you who have came to me and just, you haven't pried, you haven't, you know, asked for the juicy details or anything like that. You have just come with grace. And I just want to say thank you for that. Thank you for praying for me and encouraging me and helping me be able to walk through this. And I believe that God will bring healing, because He's the God of gods who brings life. And so I just wanted to share that with you this morning. If you have your Bibles, I invite you, encourage you to turn there already. We're going to be spending most of our time in the book of Romans. Romans is in the New Testament, comes after the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. It's the sixth book of the New Testament. And we're going to be in chapter 7 and chapter 8. And I just invite you to turn there. And I want to encourage you about something. I think it's easy to come to church and rely on this thing. And while I'm really grateful that we have this technology, I was reminded this week as I was sitting with a friend, And my friend pulled out his wife's Bible that he had been using for his devotions. And my friend has a little more gray in his hair than I do, so he's been around a little bit longer. But I was just blown away as he opened up his wife's Bible of all the notes and all the highlighting and all the underlining and literally years, decades of spending time in God's Word, making connections. And one of the things that we lose with our smartphones is we lose that ability to take record of how God is speaking to us in a moment. And so I just want to invite you that while we have this technology and you have your phones, bring your Bibles. Bring your Bibles, bring a pen, bring a highlighter. It's okay for you to mark up your Bibles. In fact, I would strongly encourage you to do so. And if you don't have a Bible, we have Bibles out in our resource area where you can pick them up. We use the NIV here. It's not the end-all, be-all, but it's the one that I typically preach from. And so I want to encourage you to come to church ready to receive from God. You know, God has something that he wants to give you this morning. And I want to encourage you to take record of that in your Bible in the moment that God wants to meet with you. And so I just wanted to share that with you this morning, just as an encouragement to do that as we gather. I don't know if you've ever heard this saying. This morning we are talking the first value of the Free Methodist Way. And the first value of the Free Methodist Way is life-giving holiness. And I don't know if you've ever heard this spoken before. It's a pretty common phrase used by Christians and by the church, something along the lines of, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Have you ever heard someone say that? I've used it myself. I've said it many times, right? Because I want to have the humility that I believe that God's calling me into. And so I will refer to myself that I'm a sinner saved by God's grace. I want to tell you this morning, I'm no longer using those words because don't we become the things that we say? Don't we? And when I say I'm a sinner saved by God's grace, I'm not discounting God's grace portion of that, but aren't I tripping myself up by choosing to refer to myself as a sinner? The truth is that I stand before you this morning no longer as a sinner. I stand before you as a child of God, sanctified through Christ. That's who I am this morning. And if you've experienced God's forgiveness in your life, if you've received his gift of grace, you are no longer a sinner. You are a child of God, sanctified by the person of Jesus Christ. What we say about ourselves matters. And we need to allow ourselves to come to this place of realizing that Jesus didn't die on the cross so that we could go on sinning. Jesus died on the cross so that we might be freed from our sin and live in a life of holiness called by God. I know I directed you to Romans. We're going to read a couple verses out of 1 Peter first. And 1 Peter is a few chapters or a few books after Romans. It's before Revelation, before 1st and 2nd and 3rd John. And it says this in 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter writes this, "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance." Peter is saying, don't be sinners instead, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do, for it is written, "Be holy because I am holy." This is who we are called to be. We are called to be holy children of God. And here the important truth for us to recognize and remember this morning is this, that we can be holy because he is holy. Now that might seem like such a simple truth, but I guarantee you many Christians get tripped up in believing that they can be holy because they choose to be holy. Many of us fall into the temptation of thinking that we can be holy because we can act holy, or we can choose to be holy, or we can do enough to be holy, but none of that matters. In fact, none of that actually moves the needle for us in holiness. The only reason any of us have any ability to be holy is because God is holy. That is it. That's the only reason. And Peter tells us that here in this passage, that we can be holy because God is holy. In Romans chapter 7, Paul is writing here, and he's writing on the subject of law and sin and holiness. And we're going to jump in here in chapter 7 at verse 7. And like I said, I encourage you to follow along in your Bibles. And this is a bit of a legal argument that Paul is putting forth. And so while there's a lot of legal jargon in here, I encourage you to just to stay focused and stay present with this. This is what Paul writes. He says, "What shall we say then? Is the law sinful? Certainly not. Nevertheless, I would not have known what sin was had it not been for the law. For I would not have known what coveting really was if the law had not said, 'You shall not covet.' But sin, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, produced in me every kind of coveting. For apart from the law, sin was dead. Once I was alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin sprang to life and I died. I found that the very commandment that was intended to bring life actually brought death. For sin, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, deceived me, and through the commandment put me to death. So then, the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, righteous, and good. Did that which is good then become death to me? By no means. Nevertheless, in order that sin might be recognized as sin, it used what is good to bring about my death, so that through the commandment sin might become utterly sinful. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for I do what I do not, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but sin, it is the sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I want to do. This I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is the sin in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself in mind am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature a slave to the law of sin." A few weeks ago, I was at one of our daughter's soccer games, and there was this amazing young woman who was reffing the game. She was only a teenager, probably couldn't have been any older than 15 or 16 years old, and she was reffing this soccer game between little kids, little girls who were just learning how to play the game of soccer. And if you don't know this, there's only one person on a soccer team that's allowed to touch the ball with their hands. It's the goalkeeper. Everyone else, it doesn't matter what reason for, if your hands or your forearms touch the ball is called dead. And it doesn't matter if the ball is coming hurtling at you at 700,000 miles per hour and you put your arms up in defense to protect your face, if the ball hits your forearms or your hands, it is dead and it's the other team's ball. I watched in amazement as this teenage girl with such grace and mercy reffed the game. Inevitably, there were moments where a ball would be coming at one of the little girls' faces, and she would raise her hands up, and she would block it, and the ref would blow it dead, and before she had an opportunity to say anything, the little girl would acknowledge what she had done. And I loved the grace that the ref had. She would come up to the girl, and she would say, "You know what you did, right?" But she didn't say it in a way that was like, "You know what you did, right?" She did it with grace. She was acknowledging that in order to play this game the right way, there were rules that had to be followed. But she also knew that these little girls were learning the sport. And even though the girls knew intrinsically that they weren't allowed to touch the ball with their hands, they couldn't help themselves. Instinctively, when a ball is coming at them, they either went to grab it or block it, and they called it dead. You see, sometimes we look at rules or the law, and we believe it's a bad thing. Because it's because of the law that we actually are guilty of not keeping it. But this morning, Paul reminds us that the law, that is God's commandments all throughout the Old Testament, even the New Testament, as Pastor Matt shared with us, that the law is actually holy, righteous, and good. The law isn't evil. It isn't bad. It isn't the reason why we get in trouble. We get in trouble because we're sinful people, and we have this problem with sin. The law, though, is God's holy, righteous, and good word to us. If it weren't for the law, we would never know how we're breaking the rules. And if we didn't know how we were breaking the rules, we would never learn to live in a different way. This is what Paul is reminding us here, and he says this. When I was in youth ministry, we often called this chapter the doo-doo chapter. Because he would say the things that he would want to do, but were incapable of doing it, and the law would expose it. And because of the law, now he realizes that he was incapable of doing it. And so it's important for us to recognize that when it comes to God's holiness, that his law is holy, righteous, and good. But it's also important for us to recognize that his law, God's law, is powerless to make us holy. You see, the law does one thing. And only one thing. It exposes our inability to keep his law. That's it. You can't help someone who doesn't realize that they have a problem. And if we don't realize that we have problems, then God can't help us. And so what the law does is that it doesn't make us holy. It actually exposes the fact that we need God and his help. Look at, as we continue on in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, Paul writes, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For where the law was powerless to do, it was weakened by the flesh. God did by sending his own son in likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering." Paul makes it really clear here that the law is powerless to actually make us holy, but he didn't leave us in the muck and mire. He didn't leave us stuck in our sin. He sent Jesus to do for us what the law cannot do for us, and that is to save us. And so he condemns sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. It's so important for us to hear that this morning. We are not sinners saved by grace. If we live in the realm of the Spirit, we are no longer sinners. We are children of God. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh, to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live by the Spirit, you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him, we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are also heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his suffering, in order that we may also share in his glory. You see, it's through Jesus that we receive the Holy Spirit and life-giving holiness. God tells us to be holy because he is holy. And so many of us, we spend our lives trying to work on behavior modification. We try to do better, act better, be better. We try to do it in our own abilities. We try to read our Bible more. We try to pray harder. We try to go to church more regularly. We try to give more of our time and our resources. We try to be holy, but we leave the most important component of that holiness out of the whole equation. We leave the Holy Spirit. Through Jesus, we receive the Holy Spirit and his life-giving holiness. We cannot be holy apart from the Holy Spirit. And the reason why is because holiness is in his name. He's the Holy Spirit. If you are tired of living this life, if you are tired of doing what Paul says, I know what I should not do, but I cannot stop doing the things that I do not want to do. If that is you this morning, the solution to that problem isn't trying harder, isn't being better, isn't moving further along in your journey. The solution is actually surrendering yourself to the presence and the person of the Holy Spirit in your life. It's only through him that we are actually capable of being holy. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, invade my life. Holy Spirit, reveal to me the areas of my life that need healed, that need change. Holy Spirit, do the work in me that I cannot do on my own. We are trying to be holy without the Holy Spirit, and you cannot be holy without the Holy Spirit. Psalm 139 says this. It's a familiar passage probably to many, but David wrote this. This is how we allow the Holy Spirit to do the work in us that needs to be done. David wrote this. He said, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting." We are to be holy because God is holy. The only way to holiness is through the Holy Spirit. The only way to experience holiness from the Holy Spirit is to invite him to search us and to reveal in us the areas and the places that need to be healed. I was reading in my devotions this past week, and I was in Mark chapter 10, and it's a story where Jesus is walking with his disciples, and along comes a guy who was rich, and he comes to Jesus, and he says to Jesus, "Jesus, tell me what I have to do in order to get to heaven," essentially. What he's saying is, tell me what I have to do in order to be holy like you are holy. And so Jesus tells him, do not murder, do not steal, don't commit adultery. He basically starts going through the Ten Commandments with him. And the guy, I'm imagining, begins to puff up his chest and look at Jesus, and he's thinking in his head as Jesus is rhyming off all these commandments, he's probably going, check, check, check. He's thinking there's a gold star in this for him. And when Jesus is finished, he says, I've done all that. What else can I do? And Jesus looks at him and he says to him, take all of your stuff and sell it and give it to the poor. And Mark tells us that this guy who moments earlier was so confident in his own self-holiness walked away from Jesus absolutely despondent. Because Jesus got to the heart of the man's heart. Jesus searched him and knew him. Jesus saw if there was an offensive way in him, and Jesus, in his commandment to sell all his stuff, was trying to lead the man in the way everlasting, which was holiness. Jesus exposed an idol in the man's heart, and the man walked away not receiving the holiness that he had for him there that day. What struck me as I read this story, probably for the 100th time at least in my life, was something that happened before Jesus said anything to the man. In verse 21, when the rich man comes to Jesus and pleads his case, Mark records this. He said, Jesus looked at him and loved him. Just want that to settle in for a moment. Jesus knew what the outcome of the conversation was going to be. He knew that the man's own self-evaluation of his own holiness was not true holiness. Jesus knew that this man was going to leave less confident than he came to him in the first place. Jesus knew exactly what was wrong with this man. And yet Mark tells us that Jesus looked at him and loved him. Jesus wasn't chastising him. He wasn't condemning him. He didn't strike him down or wag his finger at him. He didn't criticize him. Jesus looked at this man with love. And when he looks at you and I, he looks at us with love. That is his default. That is his bare foundation. He is looking at you right now where you're at with whatever it is that you're dealing with, whatever way that you're trying to be holy, maybe on your own accord, in your own way. And he's looking at you and he's saying, I love you. If you never read another page of the Bible, if you never go to another church service, if you never give another dollar or another minute of your time, if you never do another thing for me, I want you to know right now, I love you. And if you can come to the place of realizing that that stuff doesn't actually earn us holiness, but comes in response to God's holiness, it will take on a whole new different meaning. Our resources, our time, our devotional time with God won't be about trying to earn something from him, but instead receiving something from him. The fact that he's our Father, and we can cry out to him, Abba, Father. We can say to him, Daddy, I love you. He's calling us to holiness, and holiness is not something we purchase or earn or do. It is something we receive from the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. I want to invite the worship team to come forward. What this means is the only way that we experience holiness in our lives comes through surrender. If that rich man had surrendered his life and his things to God that day, he would have experienced holiness unlike anything he'd ever experienced before. The last several weeks, we've been inviting you to come and to surrender things. I feel like every message over the last several weeks has been about the theme of surrender. And I keep asking God, God, are you sure that's what you want the invitation to be? Surrender again this week? And the Holy Spirit says, yes, again this week. Surrender, 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 surrender until you can't surrender anymore. And when you can't surrender anymore, then God has you at the place where he is just filling you with everything that you have. And so many of us were like that rich young ruler, and we don't want to surrender the things that matter the most to us. And so this morning, once again, the invitation is this. Instead of trying to be holy, Surrender all your things, all your stuff. Surrender yourself. Come and say, search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting, which is to receive the presence of his Holy Spirit so that we might be made holy as he is holy. And some of us, we have to let go of the things that we're unwilling to surrender to him. And so this morning, I invite you to come to the front, to this altar, and surrender it. Lay it at his feet. You will be amazed at how free you feel and experience and what God unleashes in you. It is unbelievably life-changing. In fact, it's the only thing that will give you life, is when you choose to surrender these things to God. And sometimes, and for some of us, it's a daily surrender to him. And so, yes, the invitation is surrender again. Surrender yourself to God. Surrender the things that are holding you back. If work is hard, surrender that to God. If your classes aren't going the way you hope for, if you're experiencing stress because the assignments are piling up and the tests are overwhelming, surrender that to God. If you are living for something, thinking that the next thing I purchase, the next vacation I take, the next event that I go to, surrender that to God, because none of those things are going to last. None of those things will satisfy the hunger that is in you for holiness. If you're struggling with relationships in your marriage and in your home and in your neighborhoods and places of work, surrender that to God. Let go of that to God. Let him help you and take you and lead you in that. So come this morning and surrender these things to God. Let the Holy Spirit lead you into his holiness. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you call us to be holy like you are holy. I thank you that you lead us to these places, that you are not content to let us satisfy ourselves with the things that this world has to offer, but you call us to feast on you and your holiness. God, I thank you that you make it possible through the presence of the Holy Spirit in our life to know what it is to be holy, to no longer be controlled by sin and the law, but to be set free from it through the holiness of the Holy Spirit. And so I pray that even now as we pray, that you would be moving people, inviting people, that you would allow them to let go of the grip that they have on the things that they think will lead them to that holiness, but they will trust you and hold tightly to you. I pray that you would continue to do that work in my own life, God, that you would help me to no longer crave and hunger after the things that this earth and this world has to offer, but that I would hunger after you and your kingdom, that I would listen to the Holy Spirit, that I would fling open the doors of my life, that I would allow the Holy Spirit to come and to show me what doesn't work, to show me what sin needs to be taken care of, to show me where healing needs to be brought in. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you would do the work that no one else can do, including myself. Make me holy as you are holy. In your name we pray. Amen.
Guides my heart.
Most significant thing that we could ever do in our lives is learn how to surrender to God. And that can happen anywhere at any time. The best time for it to happen is when the Holy Spirit convicts us of our sin. That's his role. He came to convict the world so that we might recognize that we need help and that we need his forgiveness. And the Holy Spirit doesn't just live in this building or in this space. The Holy Spirit lives in each and every one of you when you receive Christ's forgiveness. The Bible's clear on that, that when we receive forgiveness from Christ for our sins, that we are also given the presence of the Holy Spirit in our life. And so I would invite you, this time is not going to go away. And for those of you who are up here, I encourage you to continue to stay. We have people in our back who would love to pray with you in our prayer corner. But having these moments of surrender at the end of service, this is what God calls us to. He calls us to action. And so I invite you, if not today, then as the Spirit leads, choose to surrender whatever it is that he's asking you to surrender in your life to him. Thank you for worshiping God with us here this morning. There are some things back on the table there that the Free Methodist Church has put out about this, and for this morning, Life-Given Holiness, we have a few of these. If you want to learn more about that, I encourage you to pick one up and take a read and just be encouraged by that. We look forward to seeing you next week. You're dismissed. Have a great week.